Everybody, my name is Stephen Cohen, and on behalf of the Mirowitz Center, I'm delighted and honored to welcome you all here today, and in particular to thank and welcome our guest, Professor Jeff Zacks. This program is co-sponsored today with the St. Louis NORC, and I'm happy to see my colleague, Sarah Zoller-Levinson, who is the St. Louis NORC manager, joining us as well. Thank you, Sarah. By way of introduction, Professor Zacks received a BA from Yale and a PhD from Stanford, and he is the professor and associate chair of psychological and brain sciences at Washington University, where he studies perception, memory, and action using converging cognitive neuroscience methods across the lifespan. His research has been funded by NIH and NSF and private foundations since 1999. He has received awards from the NSF and several scientific societies, is a fellow of 5 scientific societies, including the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Professor Zacks has written 2 books, co-written a 3rd, and co-edited 2 volumes, and he has published 100 journal articles and has written for Salon, Aeon Science, and the New York Times. He has a long-standing interest in film and media, which led him to write Flickr, Your Brain on Movies. Professor Zacks, thank you so much for coming and for talking with us today.
Flickr.
Thank you so much, Stephen. And it's great to see Sarah here, and thanks to Judy, and thanks to all of you for joining us today. I'm going to share a screen here. All right, can I get a couple thumbs up if you can see that slide?
Yes.
Excellent. So my aim today is to talk a little bit about what we know about human memory and how it changes and evolves over our adult lifespans, and to engage some discussion. So I brought about 20 minutes of slides, we've got, I'm told, up to an hour. And please feel free, as I'm talking, to either raise your virtual hand or just turn on your camera and start waving. And hopefully Judy or I will see you real quick and we can answer your questions as we go. But I'm also leaving lots of room for discussion at the end. I need to start by saying that though I am a neuroscientist and psychologist who studies memory and comprehension and related topics, I often feel that I'm a total fraud because I have a kind of notably poor episodic memory. So I feel like this guy often. You know, here's a guy talking to a big crowd and he's reading off a slide saying, "Welcome to the Memory Improvement Seminar." And many of us have strong intuitions about our memories and how they have developed as we've lived. And some of those intuitions are right and some of them are totally wrong. And as scientists, one of the really exciting things about doing psychology is that unlike a field like geology or chemistry, our intuitions are always kind of smacking us in the face. You know, if I'm a chemist, I tend not to come in with a bunch of pre-existing intuitions about the binding properties of a particular organic compound. But I have lots of ideas about how my memory and perception work. So what I want to talk about today is, what do we know about memory and aging? And what can each of us do to promote the health of our brains as we develop as adults? The first thing I need to do is a little bit of kind of tedious terminology, because when everyday people like us use the term memory, it quickly becomes apparent that's not referring to just one thing. And in the laboratory, when we study memory and cognition, particularly in the context of aging, there are lots of things that we are studying. So I want to just briefly describe some of the different flavors of memory and thinking that we study in the lab. And I'm going to do this with illustrations from some of the laboratory tests that we might use, so you get a sense of how we're measuring these things. So if I use a term like short-term memory, That could mean a bunch of different things depending on the context. In the context of psychological experiments, it means basically memory for stuff that is presented to me and I more or less immediately retrieve it. There's a term working memory that is closely related to short-term memory, but in the lab, we reserve it for cases where we not only have to retrieve recently presented information, but also do something with it. So for example, if someone reads me a phone number and I can just repeat it to myself until I have to use it, that would be short-term memory. But if someone reads me a phone number and says, hey, can you tell me what that number would be if we added one to each of the digits? That would be an example of working memory. I'm having to do something with that information while I maintain it. Now, long-term memory, in real life, when we say I've got a good long-term memory or a bad long-term memory, or that's a long-term memory question, usually we mean something like years ago. In the lab, long-term memory really means anything that is long enough ago that I couldn't have just been rehearsing it. So if I am watching a television program and there a phone call comes in and I'm interrupted for a couple minutes, all of that stuff that came before, that's in long-term memory now. It's no longer in my short-term or working memory. And long-term memory is the domain that we're often most concerned about when we think about memory across the adult lifespan. And then finally, sometimes when we use memory, what we really mean is knowledge. So if I say something like, so-and-so has a really good memory for baseball statistics, what I mean is that they know a bunch of things about baseball. They have a lot of facts about baseball at their command. And it's also worth noting that for lots of the things that we do in our thinking lives, it's not just how much we know that matters, but how quickly we can access it. So I'm going to describe a study that used tasks to measure each of these things, including speed, and tell you about some of what we learned from it. So let's just work backwards, starting with speed. The speed of processing is easy to measure with a task like this. If I just throw up a screen full of letters and ask you to draw a line through all of the E's. So your task would be to search through this and find all of the E's and just cancel them out by drawing a line. It's not a difficult task. We could all do it. We might miss one or two, but that's not a big deal. But we would vary in how quickly we could do that. So we could use that to measure how fast people can go. If we wanted to measure short-term memory, then I might just read you a list and ask you to repeat it back. So let's try a couple of these. I'll ask you to go ahead and unmute now, because I'm going to read this list and then ask everybody to shout out the answers. So if you don't mind, unmute yourself. Let me start reading this list. Here we go. 1, 3, 4, recall.
1, 3, 4.
Excellent. Okay. Now here's another one.
8, 6, 7, 5, 3, 0, 9.
Those of you who know the old Tommy Two-Tone song are able to use your long-term memories, your knowledge, to solve that one as well. Here's one more. 5, 0, 9, 1, 7, 3, 8, 1, 7, 2, recall.
5, 0, 9, 7, 3, 5, 1, 2.
Nice. So, you know, lots of us could get some of them, but probably not all of them. So that last one probably exceeds the capacity for most, though not all of us on this call. And so that's one way that we can measure. We just present a bunch of lists and see what's the longest one I can remember. That would give me a measure of my short-term memory span. Okay, so remember, working memory involves holding on to information while you do something with it. So here's an example of working memory test. Leave yourself unmuted, because what I'm going to ask you to do is clap whenever a number is the same as the one two numbers ago. So I'm going to read a sequence of numbers.
Oh, no. Oh, okay.
And then, so if I read 3, 8, 9, 8, you would clap on the 8 because it's the same as the previous 8. And then if I kept reading 7, 5, 7, you'd clap on this 7 because it's the same as two ago. So your job is to clap whenever there's a number that was repeated 2 ago. Here we go. 5, 7, 5, 3, 9, 2, 9, 8, 1, 4, 1, 2. Okay, so you can get the sense, the clapping's a little hard over Zoom, but you can get the sense that for a task like that, you have to put stuff into memory and also keep updating it. So you're doing stuff with the memory while it's not just sitting there. So that's working memory. Okay, everybody can mute again now. We can measure long-term memory lots of different ways. Here are two measures that were used here. If I just present cards with a lot of simple abstract designs, and then after a delay, say 20 minutes, half an hour, show you a bunch of cards that were presented and a bunch of cards that weren't presented and ask you which of them you'd seen, that would be a way of measuring your ability to remember in long-term memory a visual pattern. To measure long-term memory for verbal materials, we can present lists of words and then ask you to remember. And one way that we can boost performance on a task like this a little bit is by giving cues that help retrieve some of the information. So for example, if I presented a list like this and asked you to remember and then said, there are a bunch of animals on that list. Can you think of all the animals? You might get a couple more by virtue of that category cue. Okay, so long-term memory, as we see in those two tasks, is memory for the particulars of experiences after some delay that includes distraction. I just want to emphasize, this isn't what we usually mean when we talk about long-term memory in everyday life. It can be just a couple minutes, as long as we couldn't be rehearsing through them. Okay, verbal knowledge is things like facts and word definitions. So if I gave a vocabulary test, like including questions like what's the definition of quagmire, or a knowledge test like what were the last two states admitted to the United States, that would be a way of measuring knowledge. So we've got all of these things. We've got speed of processing, short-term memory, working memory, long-term memory, verbal knowledge. If we test a large sample of people, how do we see that those tests, performance on those tests changes over the lifespan? Now, I said change here, but I need to emphasize that this study is not measuring one person for 80 years. It's measuring different groups of 20-year-olds, 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds, 60-year-olds, 70-year-olds, and 80-year-olds. So if we plot the performance of these groups as a function of their age, what we see is that all of us are getting, all of us who are say in their 50s or later, so I'm 51, are likely to be slower than my undergraduate students who are in their teens and 20s. We see that short-term memory capacity goes down a bit. Working memory is a little bit lower in older adults. Long-term memory is a little bit lower in older adults. But verbal knowledge increases monotonically throughout the lifespan. So the farther along we go in testing people as a function of age, the better we see them performing on tests of knowledge. So there is a general pattern of slower performance in older adults. And related to that is reduced performance on tasks like short-term and working memory. But there are some important functions that show age-related improvements throughout the adulthood. Performance on memory tests is affected dramatically by the relationship between the individual and the materials. So unlike the task that we just practiced, most of the important tasks that we do are complex and meaningful, and they're based on knowledge. So in this study, my colleague Art Shimomura and his collaborators tested community younger and older adults from the Berkeley, California area, and his colleagues in the university, professors. You can understand how I might take a personal interest in a study like this. They gave them tests of standard laboratory measures and also tests in which they had to recall passages of prose. Some of these passages were just stories, some of them were technical passages. The data for the standard lab tests looks like what I showed you. The older professors did worse than the younger adults on those measures. But if we look at the memory for meaningful material, so first what I'm going to do is just show you the pattern for the community dwelling adults. So people recruited from the general population, we see the same kind of aging effect, though it's a bit smaller than for the laboratory measures. The three passages they used were just a story and a technical passage about the atmosphere and a technical passage about anthropology. And what we see is that for the professors, there's no age effect. And for the passage about the Earth's atmosphere and to a lesser degree for the anthropology passage, you see that the professors are doing well, better than the people from the rest of the community, which kind of makes sense. They might happen to know more about those topics because of their jobs. But if you look at the memory for the story, it's not that they're doing like crazy well overall, they're just hanging in there without showing an age difference. And what that suggests to me is two things. That when we remember meaningful information, we're able to capitalize on that improving knowledge in order to foster better performance. And also that how we habitually approach the material that we're trying to remember is going to determine how we perform. So if you engage in activities, if say your job requires reading a lot and thinking about what you're reading, then that's likely to be helpful in maintaining effective memory performance. So one last important, really important point is that our cognitive performance is embedded in our social environment. And different social environments support different attitudes and habits about cognition. And one of the ways that social environments differ is that cultures have different stereotypes about cognitive performance and age. So in the US, we have a cultural belief, a stereotype that cognition gets worse with age. In China, there's not really much of that stereotype, and there's much more of a tradition of venerating the wisdom of elders. And so to explore the relationship between those stereotypes and cognitive performance, a group of scientists studied memory performance of older and younger participants in the US and in mainland China. They measured memory with multiple laboratory measures, the sort that we've been talking about before, and they also measured attitudes towards aging. So first, let's look at the attitude data. So in the US, the bars in orange, we see that, that older adults have a bit more positive attitude toward aging than do younger adults. But if we compare the orange bars to the blue bars, we see that attitudes toward aging are much more positive in China than in the US. This is a 1-7 scale where 3.5 is neutral. So attitudes are on the positive end of this scale in China. If we look at people's memory performance, we see that in the US, again, looking at the orange bars, older adults are doing less well than the younger adults, and this is a fairly large effect. But in China, the effect is negligible. So we don't know exactly what the cause and effect relationship is, but there's a strong cultural difference here in performance on the exact same memory test, and it's related to attitudes toward aging. And one possibility is that the kinds of resources that we bring online depend on our expectations and the cultural situation that we're embedded in, and that has an effect on how we perform on these kinds of tests. And I think it's, of course, important to remember that, like, most of the people that I work for in my business, and most of the people who run the show in general are older adults, right? So you may recognize Warren Buffett, who is 91 and one of the richest and most powerful investors in the world. Our president is 78. One of my heroes, Margaret Atwood, is 81 and just won the Booker Prize for Literature this year. Leonard Slatkin, another of my heroes, just conducted, I heard him conduct a wonderful concert at Powell Hall 2 weeks ago, conducting new music with the St. Louis Symphony, and he conducts all over the world about 300 days a year. So it's clear that the picture that governs cognitive performance is complex, it's multifaceted, and it's very much culturally embedded. And that in lots of contexts, it's older adults who are really in charge of the show. Okay, so I want to switch gears a little bit and just finish up by talking a little bit about some of the components of this system that we as individuals have direct control over. So very often when I talk about memory and cognition across the lifespan, people ask me, you know, what can I do to facilitate effective performance as I grow older? And one of the things that we know is a powerful modulator of cognitive performance across the lifespan is cardiovascular fitness. So in studies of non-human animals, there's been extensive demonstration that imposing on a rodent or a primate a exercise regime increases the number of neurons, increases the connections between the neurons. And in humans, we mostly look at the functional activity of the brain and we see corresponding results. So I'm going to show you some data from a magnetic resonance imaging study that measures brain function, measures the degree to which the metabolic activity of the brain is affected by doing a cognitive task. And if we have more or fewer neurons in an area, if we have more or fewer connections, that might well affect how some components of the brain are going to function. And if some components are functioning less effectively, it might turn out that other components would have to compensate to fill that gap. And in multiple studies of the effects of exercise on brain physiology, that's what's been observed. So what I'm showing you here are three slices through the brain illustrating the data from a study that measured increases and decreases in brain activity as people did a cognitive task. So the slice on the left here is a slice as if it were going this way through my brain at about here. The slice in the middle is the same thing a little higher up. And then the third slice is what's called a sagittal slice going this way through the brain, a little bit off center. And these first two are showing areas that were more activated in people who were exposed to a fitness intervention than people who were not exposed to that fitness intervention. And we see larger activation when they're doing the cognitive task in these areas, in the parietal lobe, in the back of the brain, and in the frontal cortex. And then this area in the medial part of the brain, in what's called the anterior cingulate cortex, we see the opposite pattern. We see larger increases in people who did not get the fitness intervention. So one possibility is that the health of these regions has been affected by increased blood flow. And so these are more active in the fit people. And this area, which is thought to be important for cognitive control, might be having to do more work to do the tasks in people who don't benefit from this intervention. But okay, so brain pictures is one thing, but what most of us care about is this really going to affect my performance in everyday life? And I won't show you particular studies, but I want to just read the conclusion of a large meta-analysis of the effects of exercise interventions on cognitive performance. This is a few years ago, but the picture was quite clear even then. And what they wrote was that the answer provided by the present analysis is an unequivocal yes. Fitness training increased performance a half a standard deviation. So that if you're increasing a half a standard deviation, that would basically jump you from being like in the bottom quarter of performance up into the top quarter. regardless of the type of cognitive task, the training method, or participant's characteristics. So to put it all together, memory definitely changes across adulthood. And some of those changes are negative, consistent with the beliefs that we tend to hold in the US, but not all of them consistent with the beliefs that they tend to hold in other parts of the world, like China. And second, brains need cardiovascular capacity, and we can directly intervene to increase our cardiovascular capacity. It doesn't have to be taking on, ultra marathon training. We're talking about, tens of minutes a couple times a week, just elevating your heart rate. And it doesn't have to be one particular activity, walking, running, swimming, water aerobics, exercise bikes. They all seem to be equivalently effective. Okay, so I will wind up there, but I would love to just close by making one pitch, which is my laboratory and others at the university are always recruiting people of all ages to participate in these kinds of studies. And if you are interested, we would love to hear from you. We're doing some really interesting studies right now, looking at memory for interesting everyday activities. And there's lots of interesting stuff going on. So we would love to hear you in that capacity as well. But right now I'm looking forward to